Can I get a tribe check?
Well, welcome everyone to Tribe Check. We got a little different of a look this week. Of course, normally I put out an episode on Mondays. Here we are a little bit later in the week, and I have somewhat of a co-host with me this week, of course. Not sure if he knew that he signed up for that, but we're just going to be kind of chatting about, of course, the exciting regional that we just had in Tallahassee and the super regional coming up. So, but before we get into all that, welcome, Conor Grady. Thank you for joining me.
Yeah, thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
I told you before, but we'll probably bring you back so that we can learn all about you and you can tell us how great to be a Seminole.
But it wasn't that long ago, so
it wasn't, and I'm sure
I
remember you.
Yeah, hopefully we'll see.
Well, I'm sure you want to talk about pitching. We kind of talked a little bit before about what we wanted to talk about with this episode, but yeah, like I said, for you guys watching, it's not super interview based. We're just kind of going to be chit-chatting about what has gone on. And I guess we can't really start anywhere other than the pitching for regionals. It was great from start to finish, you know, from Friday to Sunday. You couldn't really ask for more out of your pitching, starting, of course, with Carson Dorsey. Mm-hmm. What are your thoughts? It's just...
Yeah, you know, I mean, when it gets down to postseason, usually you never know kind of what a coach is going to do with your rotation, because obviously throughout the season you have your Friday, Saturday, Sunday guys. And for us this year, it was kind of, you know, we dealt with injuries with two of our weekend starters throughout the year. Thank God we have Connor Whitaker back out there throwing again, so that's helpful. But, you know, I was interested in seeing who Link was going to go with to start that first game of the regional. And I mean, I think it played out perfectly how everyone had hoped it would play out. Carson Dorsey went out there and threw 8 2/3, which is, you know, almost unheard of. People don't do that. An excellent outing to just set the tone for the whole weekend. And, you know, I think it really picked up the rest of the team to, and especially the bullpen as well, because we had Oxford threw, I think, just one batter in that game. Mm-hmm. And that's huge for the bullpen, especially, you know, throughout this season, especially recently in the later season, the bullpen has gone out there and has struggled here and there. It happens. And for that to set the tone for the weekend really kind of pushes the bullpen and has gives them confidence to go out there and to only in your mind think that you only have to win two more games. You know, you only got to win three to win the weekend. And just having Dorsey go out there and throw that first game of the regional was huge for them.
Well, yeah, and you know, you mentioned Ox only coming out for one batter. He only had three pitches and strikeout.
And then you have, I think Oxford closed the second game as well. So after, I mean, every single week Jamie goes out there and he's just excellent. But mm-hmm. It was like going into that Sunday game, being like, you've only used one bullpen arm and barely. Like, Oxford was even available Sunday. So it was like, it was incredible how the weekend went on the pitching side. Obviously, on the offensive side, that's been a constant the whole year. But it was, like, amazing to see and really cool to see that Link has that has his confidence in Ox to come out there and be able to finish the first game and finish the second game. I think that was really important to see.
You saw the confidence in Dorsey as well. And I think a lot of people maybe forgot about that because, you know, throughout the season, like you said, with a couple of your starting pitchers going down, it's tough. Who's going to step into that role? And Dorsey stepped up into that role for the entire season. And yeah, maybe in the ACC championship, he dipped a little bit, maybe not his best outing, but it's always been there. So for someone like that, it just makes you more excited to see him go out.
Right. And you know, I think it's really important to, like you mentioned in the ACC tournament, the bounce back is really important, almost like turning the page. And for, you know, of course, everyone wants to win the ACC championship. That's why everyone's there for the tournament. But things happen and some things don't go your way. And you know what? It was cool to see from just a week later, the bounce back, just one outing later, to see the difference in the first one where I don't remember exactly, but I believe he only threw maybe what, like one or two innings of that game.
Don't remember exactly.
Yeah. It was brief, but to come back and really put like the team on your back, the first game of a regional was really important.
Yeah, I know. And then you have Jamie come out there for game two with an immaculate inning and just something that you could have hoped for. It's like, I don't know what was going on like in preparation for the weekend, but I mean, it was wild to watch.
It was wild. And I actually got to go to the game Saturday, and that atmosphere is just unreal. Like, of course, when I was here a few years ago, yes, we got crowds and everyone's great. The fans are great. But something about this year and being, because I just recently moved back to Tallahassee, so I get to go to the games now throughout this whole season I've been able to go. And just like the atmosphere of the fans in the stadium, it just feels different. And it feels like everyone's on the same train and moving in the same direction. And it's really like cool to see.
Were you able to go to the Florida game at Hauser too?
Yes, I was there. And I actually got like me and my mom and my sister came to visit me that week. And we did go to that game, and it was insane. Absolutely insane.
I've never seen Hauser like that before.
No, I agree. And another thing that I've noticed this year, especially that I feel like differed from years in the past, was it seems like more students are coming to the games now. I don't know what that drive was, or maybe, you know, it's just how well the team has performed this year. But it's really, like, nice to see that, you know, the student body is kind of rallying around this team as well.
Yeah, I totally agree. I'm interested to see what it's like this weekend with the earlier games, you know, because how's it going to get rocking, but with the weather outside, it's been so hot. And of course the earlier games, I'm not really, are you gonna try and
I can't fight? Go Friday, unfortunately, because I'll be at work, but I am going to the Saturday game. Hopefully we don't have a Sunday game, but yeah, hopefully that we just seal the deal the first two games. But yeah, the early games is weird. I'm not a fan of that. I understand, you know, TV times and whatever happens with that. But I mean, it's tough, especially for both teams, not even just us, but for UConn as well, to go out there on a Friday and play at noon and then have to bounce back and play at 11 a.m. the next day in Florida, in the state of Florida. I don't know. I think it's crazy. But I guess, you know, the slots fall where the slots fall.
Yeah, I'm kind of hoping it's an advantage for us, though, in UConn, because they're maybe not as used to the weather.
Yeah, fair. And we also did play our first regional game, I believe, was a noon game. So, you know, hey, if that's what we're going to be playing at, then regardless, you got to come out ready to go. And we showed already that we are capable of that. So hopefully it carries over into this weekend, too.
Yeah, I don't think it matters really what time it is. But going back to last weekend, I'm curious to hear your thoughts. Of course, Carson Dorsey was amazing. Jamie Arnold, amazing. Connor Whitaker was pretty good too. And yeah, that might get lost because it didn't measure up to the first two starters, but he was solid.
Absolutely. And honestly, it was cool to see like Connor Whitaker back out on the mound again, starting for us, not just, you know, because after his injury, from what it seemed like, you know, he was limited. He would only go out there and maybe throw an inning or two, maybe three. But it was nice to see him start again and be able to go five or six innings, you know, just to get deep into that game. All three starters this weekend did phenomenal, did exactly what they needed to do to get us through this weekend. And it was nice to see Whitaker back out there comfortable and competing again at the level that he wanted to be competing at. Of course, injuries, you know, they hurt, but it's nice to like see him come out there, be comfortable. Yes, he got a little shaky in the first inning, but completely closed the deal after that. No one else was even close. It was nice to, you know, yes, the offense took a little bit to catch up. I believe it was in the fifth inning when we scored all of our runs. It was like 2-0 for the first four or five innings. But, you know, that was okay. He knew his offense was going to come out there and have his back eventually in that game, as long as he held it to where it was at. So I think he did his job, exactly what he needed to do and exactly what the team needed.
No, I agree. And yeah, I will say, though, it started by that fourth inning and there was nothing really going. I was like, oh my gosh, it's the ACC championship all over again. Like, come on, guys, get something going.
And, you know, it's funny because it's not really fair to the hitters how everyone just expects them to be great all the time. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, hey, you guys have been consistent the whole year doing what you've been doing. And so at this point, we have to expect it. Like, it's on our end, it's not fair for us not to expect it. But I was a little nervous in the middle of that game being like, when are we going to start mm-hmm. getting this rolling? Yeah. Because, you know, you never want to go to a game seven and especially play on that Monday. Like, you, that's just not a comfortable thing that you want to be involved in. And so I think that it was huge that he held him. And eventually the offense picked up and took care of it.
Oh, yeah. And Cam Smith, outstanding, awesome player. I don't want to be, like, too negative with this, but just to kind of point out, James Tibbs has been very, very quiet. But to flip that in a more positive note, I think it sets him up to have a really, really good supers. I don't know if you agree, but it feels like maybe he might be getting over that hump. And I don't really know if it's a mental thing, but you know, it's probably a lot of pressure where he's at right now.
Oh, I'm sure. I mean, especially with being ACC Player of the Year and, you know, the spotlight on him for the draft as well. I'm sure it's a lot to deal with. And I've seen that with players that I've played with in the past as well. You know, when a lot of people are looking at you to do great things every time you're out there, it's not going to happen all the time because it's baseball and that's just what happens. But it's nice to also, yes, James Tibbs has been a little bit shaky the past weekend, but it's honestly really cool to see that even when James Tibbs is not hitting to, you know, where everyone expects him to be hitting, the rest of the lineup still takes care of business and still handles, you know, the game and leads the way. So even with our ACC Player of the Year not doing his, you know, not playing where I'm sure he wants to be playing either, it's cool that the pressure doesn't all have to be on him. He's got guys in front of him and behind him that can also perform at that level. And so I just think it's nice. And also, I don't know if you agree with this or not, but watching James, like, in the, like, throughout the regional, it didn't seem like he was down on himself. It didn't seem like he was, you know, pouting about anything. It's on to the next at bat, or, you know what, he's going to go out and make a play defensively, or, you know, pass the bat. You got out, now, you know, Marco Dingus is up after you, or what, you know, whatever the lineup is. But it's nice that, you know, you don't ever see him really be down on himself. And it's also, it seems like the camaraderie of this team in general, they just seem like they're having a great time every single time they're out there. So that might be part of it also, that that's just, you know, the vibe of the team. But I love seeing that. I love seeing, you know, teammates pick you up.
Well, no, he's one of the first ones out when, you know, you know, his teammate does something well. But just after talking to him, I've briefly gotten to a couple of times and just seeing the way he goes about his business, you're completely right. I think he probably knows that he's struggling just a little bit more than usual now. He has enough faith in himself and in just, you know, the higher ups and everything that he knows that he's going to get through it. And, you know, it, like you said, it's the game of baseball. It's not going to be just success over and over and over again. Like, you hit these really tough parts and it's how you handle them. And like you said, and he is just there to pick up his teammates. The camaraderie is there, and his teammates, I'm sure, are there to pick him up too. So even if there is frustration sinking in, it's like, bro, you're James Tibbs III. Like, you're going to get out of this.
Exactly. And it's, I think that it's only going to propel him to even have a better weekend this weekend. Mm-hmm. Hopefully, you know, like we talked about briefly earlier, I'm not really caught up on the UConn pitching staff. I'm not really sure, you know, what arms they have. I haven't done any of my research on that. But regardless, our offense has done phenomenal throughout the whole season, regardless of who's on the mound, whoever our opponent is, it doesn't matter. So I think the key to our weekend in supers is going to be pitching. As long as we can minimalize the runs and the mistakes, not that we make many mistakes defensively, but as long as we minimize the walks, that is what kills us on the pitching side of things. But as long as we can, you know, keep UConn to a couple runs, I think our offense should be able to take care of that. I really do.
Yeah, no, I agree with you. And I'm in a similar boat. I think we both kind of are a little bit even with our knowledge on UConn. I know we both saw the first few innings of that last game against Oklahoma and we're like, well, UConn's coming to Tallahassee. I think it's been decided.
Right.
Which is cool. I think it's fun to play a new team. Like, we've only played them once in program history.
Yeah.
And, you know, we play UCF often. It's cool to kind of have that. I felt like it got a little bit chippy there too during the UCF game. And
yeah,
we know Stetson, we know Alabama, but it's cool to play a team that you don't really play very often and you don't know
as much. And I mean, half of our regional was, or I guess it was three teams, including us from Florida, you know, it, I get it. That's how kind of things are placed. And, you know, they try to keep teams closer to wherever they're actually going. But regardless, I don't know. It's nice to play somebody, like you said, someone that's new to us, someone that is from far away. I think it's cool to bring them into town and show them how we play baseball in Tallahassee.
Yeah, and it's not Duke either. And I'm super happy. Right. I don't know about you, but thinking about that regional up there, I was like, okay, if it's UConn, that's fine. If it's Oklahoma,
right.
If it's Duke, I don't want to play Duke again. And I have all the faith in the world that we could beat them, especially at Hauser. But if we don't have to.
I agree. We don't want to see them again. Not out of fear, but just because, you know, they know us. And yes, we know Duke too, but they know our lineup. They know our pitching by now. I mean, we played them, what, 4 or 5 times this year? So, yeah, so it's just not, you know, something we want to run into. Now, the crazy part watching that UConn-Oklahoma game was that in the back of my mind, I was remembering that softball ran into Oklahoma in their supers as well. And they also, the other parallel is that they ran into Duke in their ACC tournament. So, it's interesting to our championship, ACC championship. But it's interesting because watching that game, I was really hoping, you know, I hope UConn comes over here because we don't want to – that parallel to the – to the softball team, just that can't be how this year's going to go. But regardless, it worked out with UConn coming here. And I'm excited to see, you know, what they bring to the table this weekend.
I think it would have been okay, though, if we had Oklahoma, because softball played Oklahoma in Norman. So, true. And we would be hosting them. So I think the bad omen, I think it's canceled out. I think
yeah.
But I'm cool with UConn. Honestly, I think we're okay as well. I mean, from what we saw in the few innings, they have a good offense, not super knowledgeable about the pitching, but I know their offense can definitely hit the ball.
They were putting up some runs in that regional. So
yeah,
it's nothing to be, you know, playing around with for sure. And not that anybody should be thinking this, but nobody's a pushover at this, you know, at this point in the season. Mm-hmm. And a lot of teams will shock you at this point in the season. So it's not something to look past, but I am feeling comfortable going into the weekend with, you know, what we have versus what they have.
Yeah. They've never played against Jamie Arnold before. So
exactly. Right.
We'll see exactly how they are.
Right. Exactly. And they haven't had to pitch to our lineup before. And I know a lot of teams don't like to pitch to our lineup. So it's something that is going to be really interesting to kind of see, you know, how the weekend gets started, because, you know, the first game really sets the tone, and I'm really interested to see, you know, who gets on who early in the first game, because it might really set the tone for the weekend.
So I'm going to put you in the hot seat here. You were pitching against our lineup, how would you approach it?
Based on how this season has gone, you have to keep people off the bases walks wise. You cannot walk people because of how dangerous the lineup is. They can hit, pop one out of the park at any point. So I feel like the best way to approach them would be a lot of off speed pitches, a lot of down in the zone, which obviously that's where everyone wants to throw the ball, but that's just not how things go sometimes. But I mean, they do damage. And so as long as you can take away the walks and the freebies, errors, things like that, then the damage is limited. So as long as the damage is limited, then I feel like, you know, you always got to have confidence in your own lineup. Now it's confusing to have this conversation because I always think of it as a game, not just like me versus the hitters. I think of it as like, you know, I also have my offense and defense. So it's interesting, but you know, you have to be careful with the guys early in the order because, you know, Max Williams has been out there, starts the regional off with a home run. You know, and then following him, you have Cam Smith, who's literally one of the best hitters in the country, followed by James Tibbs. You know, it just gets worse and worse as the lineup keeps going. And so it's funny because, yes, of course, watching the games in certain scenarios, I might in my head think, oh, I would throw this here. But will it work? Who knows? Like, I've always, like, watched the game thinking, you know, that I could compete, you know, in this situation and throw this pitch and blah blah blah, but you never actually know how it's going to work out. But you know, back to your question, throwing against this team, you don't really, I don't think anything's really safe.
Well, then we won't show UConn that portion of the
right.
How to do it. I'm right. Sure they'll probably figure it out, but
yeah,
I definitely don't envy anyone trying to figure that one out. I do.
I know. Good luck to all the pitching coaches that have to come over here and play us.
Work around it. Yeah. I mean, it's crazy. And then you think you get a break after Tibbs, but no, you got Dinges and Cam. Yeah. Even like Furrow and Jackson West.
Furrow and Lodies. Lodies has been great this year. Mm-hmm. I mean, to have guys that are hitting in our order 7, 8, 9 and still are hitting bombs, not many places you see that.
No.
You know? Mm-hmm. So it's something special. Mm-hmm. I think the regional was a great showing of what we can do as a team. And also, we haven't touched on this yet, but it's nice to also see that, you know, we discussed the crowd and the fans and stuff, but how hard it really is to come into Tallahassee and deal with all the people and the animals especially. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's hard to come in here and win. So I think we have that going for us too. It was huge to get that 8 spot in the national seed because it really positioned us for a beautiful road to Omaha that hopefully, you know, if we take care of business, we'll get there.
Oh my gosh. I think it's one of the toughest places to play. And the training is so hard where you mentioned the students are coming out and supporting the team too, but baseball fans at Florida State are baseball fans, you know. People think about like football fans and it's like those are diehards, but like our baseball fans are diehards.
Oh yeah, they're out there tailgating at like 9 a.m. before the game and the game's at like 6. You know, like I love the support. It's honestly amazing. Now that I've been on the flip side and I'm not playing anymore, I've gotten to, you know, hang out with the animals and I did go to a tailgate. And so I got to spend some time with them and, you know, see things from their point of view. And they're all really great people who just love the game and love FSU baseball. And it's great to see them out there, like cheering their hearts out every single weekend.
Yeah. Shout out to the animals. Is your favorite chant the K-time as a pitcher?
Of course. I mean, and you know what? Another thing about their chants is that they have a feel. They understand the game. Mm-hmm. Like they're not just, you know, yes, to a random person who hears the things they say, you might think it's a little silly, but they know that what they're saying is silly. But they also understand how the game goes, and their chants are like so personalized to each player that, you know, it kind of makes it feel like a family. And something at FSU baseball that we preach is family. And so it goes beyond just the locker room. Like it runs through the veins of everyone that cares and comes to watch the games. And the animals are awesome. It's nice to get to know them personally now and not just, you know, from K-times.
I'm sure that they appreciate you coming out and getting to know them too, because they cheered for you for so long. And
yeah,
the small ones, we got to get Reese on here to kind of talk about it. But I used to love the Fat Alberts.
Oh, yeah. The hey, hey, hey.
Yep. With his face.
Yeah. And it's cool that they go all out. They really, really go all out for all of the players. And I might sneak over there this weekend. I don't know. On Saturday, I might go sneak over and hang out with the animals for a little bit.
You might as well. They have a method to their madness too, because that fifth inning was definitely sparked by O Canada.
Oh, wasn't yeah. Crazy? I know. It is weird. It's weird when it works out that way. But, you know, it's funny because the other day I was talking with Chase Haney and we were trying to remember where the O Canada started. We still couldn't, like, we could not remember because he thought it had to do with like a hockey game, like a USA Canada, I don't know, hockey game. But yeah. I thought it was like just one of our games that they started singing it and we came back and won. So we have two different memories of how the O Canada started, but it was way before our time. So we never really got to the answer. So that's something I got to find out.
Yeah. When you go and sit with them this weekend, you'll have to ask and report back for us.
Right. I got to let you know because that we got to know the history behind it. We got to know, you know, why they're saying that.
Yeah,
but it did work. It did work this weekend. So,
also, this is not about the animals at all. But when you were watching, this just popped in my head. But when you were watching the UConn Oklahoma game, did you happen to see the graphic that they put up about Florida State?
It's been was certain- it about that? It's like the most super regionals that we. Like that anyone's been to? Was it that one?
No, it was more so just like a breakdown of who either UConn or Oklahoma's opponent was going to be. It had like some facts about FSU on it.
I don't know if I did.
So they had a bit of a typo on there.
Wait, are you talking about Max Tibbs?
Yeah.
I did see that. I saw that, but I did not see it on the game. I saw it on Twitter, actually. Mm-hmm. And yeah,
over Twitter.
That's tough. That's bad. And also when he's literally the ACC player of the year this year, I just don't see how you don't check that over and make that. But I mean, hey, somebody was not doing their job that day.
No, and I don't want to shame anyone too hard because I've made my fair share of graphics and it happens, but I mean something like that. Like that's pretty bad. I don't know if they were like out Max Williams and then change their mind or what was going on, but yeah, that was pretty.
That was, and yeah, you're right. Like I know everybody makes some, you know, mistakes, they happen, but it's just interesting to see a graphic like that be messed up, especially at this point in the year. But hey, hopefully from here on out, all the graphics are all good. They will be, because we're going to be here in Tallahassee.
Exactly. And our crew will not make those kind of silly mistakes.
No, although, they won't.
I will say one thing that I still have not lived down was one time I was on graphics and we have these like little tombstones and they go kind of at the bottom left of the screen and we put them up after home runs sometimes. And so it'll say like how far the ball went, how fast, exit velocity, all that kind of stuff. And just in a really quick, me trying to make the graphic really quick so that we can put it up on air, I put, instead of feet, I put miles.
Okay.
So the ball went really, really far. And I have not lived that one down. So I guess
also, it's happened. That is really funny, though, because it could be taken as you did it on purpose, if that makes sense. Just you know, that ball was hit a mile.
Yeah.
So it could have been, you know, you should have claimed that. You should have just been like, oh, I meant to do that.
I should have owned it. I think it was like Elijah Cabell, like back in the day when he was
perfect.
Like, he came back with like Quadzilla. Like he had thrown like 100 pounds.
Yeah, he gained like 40 pounds when he walked in the locker room. We were like, who is this guy?
Yeah, it was after that. So I was like, I guess, I mean, he could have. If anyone were to hit it that far, it'd be that guy.
I know. That's very true. That's fitting for sure.
Mm-hmm. So anyway, looking ahead at Super Regionals, we get to host again. We're excited. We're playing UConn. It's almost like after such a outstanding pitching performance in Regionals, it's like, how do you follow it? Do you, you know, how do you match it? So, I mean, what are your kind of thoughts going into this weekend?
So, my thoughts on this weekend, because it's just like a straight-up series with a team, I think that Jamie should be throwing the Friday game. I would envision. I don't know if it's announced yet. If it is, I haven't seen it. But I would think that Jamie's going to throw the first game. And hopefully, like we just discussed with that Dorsey did last week, and hopefully, you know, Jamie goes deep into the game so we don't have to use many bullpen arms. to get us through the weekend, because Saturday, I'm assuming it'll be Dorsey. And I think that if they can, at least, like, look, I don't see him going 8 2/3 again, just because, you know, that's a phenomenon. That's not something that happens often. But all we really need from our starters this weekend is to get 5 or 6 solid innings and let our bullpen arms work at the end of the game. Now, we discussed previously, yes, our bullpen arms have, you know, had their ups and downs throughout the year. But at this point in the season, you got to trust them. You got to trust that they've worked hard throughout this year and been put in uncomfortable situations to be able to experience, you know, this. This is what everyone plays for, to get to a Supers and then eventually get to Omaha. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you got to go out there and not be scared to fill up the zone. And, you know, that might result in a hit here and there, and things happen. But I feel like we have to come out and attack as a bullpen and not give freebies anymore, especially at this point in the year, because teams and lineups, especially in super regionals, you make a mistake or you give a freebie, you're going to pay for it. That's just how things go at this point in the year, because everyone's so good. But I think that, like I said, our starters just need, and hopefully Whitaker, if we do have a game 3, but hopefully we don't. But, you know, I think that if we can get through game 1, maybe using 1 or 2 bullpen arms, that we're beautifully set up for Saturday, because then it could be almost like a bullpen day if need be. And if things go good, then we don't even have to have anybody throw on Sunday. So I think it's going to be obviously a pitch-to-pitch, inning-to-inning type of deal. But I would just like to see our starters go out there and at least give us 5 or 6 and give the bullpen a good chance to, you know, close the games out.
Yeah, and you and I have talked about this before, just about how, you know, you got Jamie and he comes out and he looks so confident, and he has all season. Yep. And kind of throughout this season, you see some of the bullpen come in and they might look a little nervous. You know, they have the control and the command that you need to have to come out there. And I think during regionals, we saw Ox come out, and of course he is a veteran member and he should have kind of fire in him when he comes out. And you saw that this weekend.
Yep.
And I think even on Sunday, to the last game, you had Abraham go out there and just dominate. And they look so confident. And I think they can come out there and do that again. They have to, I mean, that doesn't happen overnight. You know, you don't get kind of crazy, confident attitude. You don't just have that. But something else you and I have talked about is the freshmen aren't necessarily freshmen anymore. They've played a season.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. And so you see them start having that confidence in themselves. And this weekend, that could really push you into.
Yeah, I agree. And, you know, like you just touched on, we did talk about that. You know, the postseason is a new season. You, as a freshman, have already played your full first year, you know. And especially with people like Abraham, who has been a main guy out of the bullpen this whole year. I don't think that, you know, like nerves or anything is really affecting him. When it comes to him going out there, I just think, you know, he's just a little bit around the box sometimes. That's all. He's not, you know, missing by much or doing anything crazy. He just has a few walks here and there and, you know, runs his pitch count up. And, you know, little things like that add up to eventually, you know, your outing not being as long or as good as you wanted it to be. But it's nice to see, especially how Link has put them all in situations throughout the year, that hopefully when you get to a weekend like this weekend, they get to go out there and show all the work that they've put in and, you know, be comfortable on our mound. And I think it especially does help that we are playing at home. It's somewhere where they're familiar with, where they're comfortable with. And, you know, the fans are rooting for you, because going when we went on this journey, we had to go to Georgia for our regional and go to LSU for our Supers. And so 2 SEC schools, of course. But, you know, I never got to see this kind of baseball be played here. So it's interesting to see how, you know, the fans are finally not just screaming at us. They're rooting for us. So, you know, I hope that at least that, you know, has a greater effect on our bullpen, especially being at home and pitching on a mound that they're so familiar and comfortable with.
The bullpen is going to have to step up. as simple as that. I think that they're going to have to come in and attack and attack and attack, and whatever happens, happens. I don't know our exact fielding percentage this year, but I'm pretty sure it's damn good because we have a really, really good defense out there. And I think that history has shown that if you just let our defense work, that you'll be all right out there.
Mm-hmm.
Our only issues this year have been beating ourselves.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Yeah. So I think, you really said it all there. Enough pitching wise. Yeah. You said it the best. I don't know if I can really even add.
Yeah. I just went on like my whole spiel right there, but
no, that was great. That was wonderful. Making my job like super easy over here. But yeah, I think we mentioned the offense has been outstanding all year. Even if you got one or two guys that's just struggling for a game or two, you know that your brothers are going to pick you back up, and it's not going to mean that you're out of the game. So, yeah, I think that they have what it takes to continue with the offensive performance. I think that the defense and the pitching all year has showed us that they can step up and definitely perform in these kind of situations. And yeah, I'm super excited for this weekend.
I'm excited too. I might have to call out on Friday. I wish I could go to that game on Friday just to see, you know, well, like I said, they haven't announced it, but I'm assuming it's going to be Jamie. Mm-hmm. So I wish that I could get out there and, you know, see him throw in person for the last time this year, because, you know, if they get to go to Omaha, I won't be able to travel over there and go. But I'm really excited to see how this weekend goes. And I'm really, really comfortable with how I think it's going to go and how I think things will play out. But I just can't wait to go out there and be in Dick Houser again for another weekend.
Me too. And if you need any more incentive other than to watch Jamie Arnold on Friday, also think about the fact that if we win Friday and we win Saturday, then you only have one more game to watch this season.
I know.
It's almost like you got
to
go.
I might have to talk to my manager and see if I can get out. You know, a lot of people at my work, they all played baseball at FSU. So hopefully, you know, they have some feel with that, and maybe they'll let us go early on Friday.
All of you guys have to get out of there.
I know. But, you know, things happen and they might hold us down. But regardless, I will be out there on Saturday right in the middle of the afternoon and enjoying some FSU baseball for sure.
All right. Well, super excited. No pun intended. And thank you so much for doing this with me. We'll definitely have you back on here too.
Yeah, of course. Thank you for having me, Emily.
Feel the band over with bands, get a little bro them a job. You can come get rich with us. You gon' eat or you gon' starve. Keep it certified. Here to send, I pay them not to rob.